is part of not just doing good work, but doing good at work and having a good life. You know, like, it doesn't all have to be high drama.
Hello and welcome to The Business of Architecture. I'm your host, Ryan Willard, and in today's episode, I will be speaking with Esther Sperber, who is the founder of Studio ST Architects based in New York City. So Esther founded ST Architects in 2003 after working at Pei Partnership Architects for more than 5 years, during which she had the privilege of working very closely with Mr. I.M. Pei, and we discuss a little bit about that in the podcast itself and some of the lessons that she learned. Esther writes and lectures on architecture and psychoanalysis, two fields of praxis that strive to reduce human distress and widen the range of human experiences. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, Lilith Magazine, the Huffington Post, among others. Born and raised in Jerusalem, Israel, she studied architecture at the Technion in Haifa and Columbia University in New York. And in this episode, we will be discussing architecture as a leadership art and what that actually means and how to bring leadership into your practice. We discuss how Esther's interest and understanding of psychology and psychoanalysis influences her leadership and architecture. And we also talk about the importance of hiring a great business coach to make sure that all of your blind spots are uncovered and that you can invest into your business the most successfully. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Esther Sperber. This episode is sponsored by Smart Practice, Business of Architecture's flagship program to help you structure your firm for freedom, fulfillment, and financial profit. If you want access for our free training on how to do this, please visit smartpracticemethod.com. Or if you want to speak directly to one of our advisors about how he might be able to help you, please follow the link in the information. Esther, welcome to the Business of Architecture. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me here. Great to be on your podcast.
Absolute delight. So you're the founder of Studio ST. You guys started, what, nearly 20 years ago?
Yep.
Well, pretty much you've been celebrating your 20th anniversary this year, is it?
Exactly. We had a little celebration.
Congratulations. That's no small achievement. And you guys have got an incredible portfolio of, you know, beautiful design work. You've worked across multiple sectors, from institutional work, housing, interiors, religious work. I know you've got a specialism in, you know, doing beautiful interiors and work with synagogues. And, you know, it's, and I know that in your past life as well, you were working at I.M. Pei's office.
Yep.
Where was that? Was that
in New York?
In New York.
So I was working in I.M. Pei's son's offices with Mr. Pei for about 5 years. It was really a privilege and an incredible experience.
Amazing. And were you working there towards the end of his life? His kind of final.
Well, he lived a very long life. So I worked there when he was in his mid 80s.
But okay, so he's
he
still
continued
young.
Working at least, you know, 10 or 15 years later. So.
Yeah. Excellent. Great. Amazing. What sorts of projects were you working on there?
I worked for about 2 years on the Ronald Reagan Hospital, which is the UCLA hospital in LA. Mm-hmm. And then we worked on a number of museums. It was great because Mr. Pei kind of could handpick the clients he wanted to work with at that point in his life. So mm-hmm. I was working on the Islamic Art Museum in Qatar.
Oh, nice.
We did a few projects that didn't end up getting built, but it was a really special place to be.
Amazing. And any kinds of architectural lessons, either in design or business, that you've kind of taken away and have kind of instilled into your own, like the future of your career?
Oh, that's a great question. Mr. Pei was a real force of nature, but in the kind of quiet gentleman kind of way. He was able to kind of smile and charm the clients into anything he thought was going to be a great building. And, you know, they'd come in with this notion that we had to cut the budget and things were going too slowly, and they would leave feeling that they had the privilege of working with a great architect and they should allow him to do whatever he wants. And it's true. They should. I mean, in the scheme of history, if the project, you know, took another year or two, nobody's going to remember that. Mm-hmm. But the building is going to stay there for decades. So, you know, I hope I learned a little bit of that, you know, that, convincing clients to do the right thing because it was in their advantage and because they were going to get something that's worth more than what they're paying for, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really, and that the relationship between the clients and the contractors and the architect shouldn't be a confrontational one. It's a kind of collaboration to try to do something really special.
And yeah,
I hope I've been able to learn a little bit of that.
Well, that's a lovely a kind of insight to glean from someone like that. Do you think that this was something that he always had the skill of being able to do, or was it something that got easier over time because of his reputation and the brand of the business?
I mean, I think it's definitely easier once you have, you know, this kind of incredible portfolio of projects that you've managed to deliver. But I think it was something that was also just part of who he was. I think he had a clear vision of what kind of architecture he wanted to do and how you achieve that. And he was able to, in that like kind of forceful, gentle way, get his consultants to stretch their abilities to the maximum and his staff to do that. And his clients as well. So I think everyone was excited to be involved in something that is, you know, cutting edge and exciting and kind of push themselves to do things that they didn't think they could do before. And that's a real talent.
Amazing. So what was it that inspired you to step out on your own? Did you leave Mr. Pei's office immediately and set up onto your own practice, or was there a kind of a process of doing that? And
so I did leave to start my own practice, but there was definitely a process of figuring out what that actually meant, what my own office would be. You know, when I left the working with Pei Partnership, I think I had a sense that I had learned a lot about architecture and about construction, but that we were working on kind of the tail end of great modernist architecture, and that, you know, we were heading into the 21st century, and that I was curious to see what that would look like and imagining that that might be a little bit different. So I had this kind of itch to do my own thing. When I left, I shared an office space with two friends. We had done a master's together at Columbia University in, you know, 5 years earlier, in 97, 98. Mm-hmm. And we had, over the years, done a bunch of competitions together on the weekends and at night, and really loved being together, but hadn't really done any real projects with clients together. So we had inherited this loft in Dumbo in Brooklyn, which at the time was still a very grungy industrial area. Now it's full of, you know, Wall Street bankers, high-end apartments. So we had this great space, and we really kind of weren't sure what we were doing. And we were lucky to all be kind of single and childless and be able to not make a lot of money. So we started by doing international competitions for probably about 6 or 8 months. Mm-hmm. And during that time, each of us got a few clients. I did a small apartment renovation, and then I got my first kind of more real project, which was a renovation of a townhouse in Brooklyn. It was a very dilapidated building, and the client bought it to convert it into 4 apartments with an extension in the back. And we had a very loose collaboration of kind of who works on what and when we help each other. And but each of the three of us had their own kind of official clients. And then it turned out that these two friends, David and Elena, got married and moved back to Europe. And so even though I didn't really mean to start up my office on my own, there was a certain comfort of being part of a group. That's kind of how it landed. So that was, you know, our first year we shared those projects together. And then after that, it was my own work.
Right. Kind of, you know, making that leap to set up your own practice, you didn't have any work that you didn't have a project or a client that you were taking or anything like that. It was kind of off into the wilderness, start doing competitions, reduce all expenses, and kind of slog it out to begin with.
Yeah, I mean, I always, so yes, in terms of try to figure it out, I always had some expenses. So one of the things that I think I did learn from working at Pei Partnership was a kind of sensibility that you have to be organized and work as if you're a big office, even if you're just one or two people. So I never worked out of my bedroom. You know, we always had an office space. We had early on set up our accounting system to be kind of very simple but organized. And I gave myself payroll when we had money. And so it was a little bit of a mix of having no work, but having an infrastructure of an office, setting up CAD standards and being very insistent that you have to draw everything on the right layer. But I think that was actually a really important piece of it, that as soon as we did get some more work, we were really set up in a good way to be able to perform that work and not have to worry about the kind of back office part of setting it up once we had a client. So yeah. I was really fortunate to have done that in the right way.
Well, this is what is very interesting about, if you look here in the UK and across the globe, how many of these, let's call them like the kind of, you know, real influential, impactful starchitect firms, essentially, not only have they been influential and impactful in terms of the built work, but also the amount of smaller practices or younger practices that have been, you know, have been generated or, you know, given birth to, if you like, as a result, I think is really, really fascinating. And often you see a very good quality of kind of systems infrastructure being taken from those offices and then executed. In terms of winning work and projects, what were your kind of first business development adventures?
So it's always been a little bit intuitive and word of mouth and networking. It's interesting because I grew up in Israel and actually came to New York to do this master's. And so it wasn't like I wasn't starting my practice in a place in which I had already kind of a big network of friends and family and colleagues. But over the years, you know, partly I've been very involved in my own Jewish community. So that was one kind of avenue in which I met people, both, you know, kind of through my synagogue and the religious practice, also through some of the kind of Israeli liberal nonprofits that I was involved in. And, you know, you go to events and meet people. So that was one side of it. You know, to a lesser extent through kind of the architectural community, but that has always been for me a little bit less of a avenue for getting business. You know, I also got some referrals from, you know, my old office, and that was a very heartwarming thing where your boss would, you know, call and say, listen, we have a project that's too small for us, or it's not the right fit. Would you be interested? And I think that speaks to some of what you were saying about the kind of smaller firms, some of which are not so small anymore, that were kind of second generation of these bigger starchitect firms. I think that would actually be really fascinating to try to kind of track that network of, you know, offices and architects that were mentored by
other architects. Yeah, like a kind of architectural family tree.
Yeah. You know, there's this really beautiful, similar thing. I mean, we might touch on this later, but I've been very interested in psychoanalysis and also how that refers to architecture. But because psychoanalysis, you know, started with Freud, you can really kind of do this family tree, and there weren't that many people involved of the different generations and who kind of analyzed who and who was a student of who. And there is this, you know, almost like a family tree, and it would be interesting to do something similar for architecture. It's also interesting because I think it fills a gap that that is not really cultivated by architecture schools. So mm-hmm. our training is part of our education. And then there's this whole second phase of our education that often happens at firms. And, you know, you learn so much about the business and about client management and about project management in a kind of apprentice type of framework. I don't know if other professions are like that or not. Probably in some ways they are.
Well, it's very interesting. I mean, I've kind of in the past, quasi jokingly, when people have asked, you know, what's the sort of the best success or best recipe for starting an architectural practice, and I've often, I've kind of alluded to, well, go and work for one of the Starkitech firms first, and get a good 10 years worth of experience, and then basically take the team that you've been working with and leave that office and use all their systems. Because, you know, on so many occasions I've seen practices been born like that and have got, in a very short period of time, gone from no work to working on very significant projects, because they've kind of cultivated all of these connections, and the CAD systems have been just directly imported. And sometimes, you know, when we're talking about whole teams moving and becoming breakaway businesses, then the relationships are already there. People know how to work already. It's like they've been incubated in another practice. And then kind of, you know, that's a very, it's a very fast way of doing it. And obviously kind of, you know, I don't think people deliberately set out to do that. It tends to happen as an organic set of reasons and politics, perhaps, of why those sorts of things emerge. But it is testament to some of the larger corporate practices or these Starkitech firms, and certainly in that world of the kind of high tech commercial projects, where those architects, those businesses have been very good at serving commerce, because there's been a lot of a need for efficiencies and need for kind of being able to talk the language of business, because that's where the clients are. And the architectural language kind of, you know, nicely fits into that as well.
Yeah. It's interesting. As I was listening to you, I was thinking about kind of my transition. And I think the piece that I've cultivated that is different is kind of slightly resisting that super efficient way of thinking. Our clients tend to be less bottom line driven, mm-hmm. whether it's, you know, interior residential projects or nonprofits, where there's definitely a concern about the cost, but sure. Doing things as quickly as possible and as efficiently as possible are not necessarily the way those types of clients work. And I've actually found it interesting that sometimes when I try to put together a schedule, you know, I would put down how much time we would need to do the design. But then I realize you have to put in a lot of extra weeks for client deliberation and their own internal process, which I'm not resentful of. I think it is part of these types of projects. And it's part of the cultivation of the client, where you need to allow them to go through those meetings and talking to the funders and talking to various committees and stakeholders and allow buy-in from the various, you know, membership groups in a community, for example, when we're doing a synagogue. And, you know, in a way, it seems like you're not being efficient, right? Because you're adding like weeks and weeks in between our different phases of design. But it's kind of the only way to do that in a way that actually brings people on and makes sure that the client is happy with the process and happy with the results, and also allows you to tweak things that you might have missed. You know, we don't know everything, and that input from the client is important. So, you know, that's one of the things I've never articulated it to myself in that way, that, you know, that I'm kind of happy to have created a practice that can somehow hold a certain inefficiency within it and still, yes, you know, survive financially and deliver the project.
Well, I mean, this is kind of part and parcel of a successful practice, right? Is that tension of design, which is iterative, creative, organic. We need to be able to create a space for it in order to go on a discovery. And a discovery process is inherently risky, and it can be very dramatic for a client, you know, because there's too many unknowns. And architects were typically very good at being able to occupy a kind of intellectual territory where you don't know what the answer is going to be. You don't know how to deal with all the complexity, and we relish it. We really love it. Whereas for a client who's paying money for it, it's like, So kind of being able to create a space to hold that, I think, is really, you know, that's a real skill. It's a real skill to be able to do that.
Yeah. And I think it's good when we can get our clients to be excited about that, you know, unknown and the discovery and realizing that what we're going to get to is something better than what they had maybe put together in the RFP that they put out for proposals. So we had an experience a while ago where we renovated a community center down in the East Village in Manhattan. And they were looking for an architect to renovate their fitness center because that was the money generating piece of this.
Sure.
But they had many, many different programs, like very niche ones, like women only swim classes for very orthodox women. And then they also had like Japanese parenting group. You know, they had a nursery school. They had a real interesting and eclectic schedule of events and classes. And when we started working with them, it became clear that like renovating the fitness center was not really what was going to transform the institution. It would be something different. And in the initial design, we proposed, you know, moving all the offices and creating a whole new lobby and transforming the ground floor to make kind of public space for all these different activities to take place, for the people that come to these activities to meet and mingle. And it was completely obvious once we said it, people are not going to like a fitness center. They can go to a million other fitness centers. They come here because it's a community center that has this kind of diversity in it. But it's nice when your clients are like, oh, right, we hired you to do one thing and we're so excited that you convinced us to do something completely different that is, you know, four times more expensive, but is really the right thing to do. And what we were actually looking for, without knowing it.
Mm-hmm. How do you, you know, when you're working with a client, and I think one frustration we'll often hear from architects in general is, you know, a client will come to an architect already with, you know, some sort of brief that's been developed, and normally a brief, certainly on institutional projects, like the brief might have been developed with, I don't know, maybe a lawyer and somebody in finance or an accountant or something like that. There hasn't been any creative input yet. And that can cause a bit of a friction sometimes because, you know, certainly in a kind of contemporary procurement system, there's a little hole that's been crafted for the architect to fit their services in and their fees. And often that hole isn't best serving to the client, let alone the architect. Have you experienced that? And if you have, like, how do you kind of navigate your way around it? And how do you like to get involved with that kind of client, these sorts of institutional clients?
Yeah, so we've definitely experienced that. I think part of the process of submitting our proposals and interviews and meeting with the clients and maybe giving them an opportunity to talk to some of our previous clients as references is to try to give that sense that part of what we can bring to the table is that process of figuring out what the project should be. I'm trying to think. I can think of a few examples of how to do that. So one example is a project we recently completed, which is a synagogue renovation in New York. And there was actually an initial kind of preliminary design project that they had reached out to some architects, and we submitted our proposal, and we were not selected. And they worked with a different firm. And that gave them, I think, a preliminary sense of what could be done and what kind of sense of a budget. But somehow at the end of that process, they also concluded that those architects were not the right fit for the real project. And so that was really exciting because they came back to us and they said, you know, now we have a budget. We think this is somewhere between, you know, $4.5 and $5.5 million. We think we want to do something in the lobby. Can you now actually do the schematic design? So that was, and that was lucky for us because I think they had done some preliminary work to get a sense of cost and get a sense of timing, which led to a task that was a little bit more clear. With many of our other similar institutional projects, I think I like to propose some kind of exploratory phase like that. So I will say, listen, let's spend 3 months figuring out what the project is and then figuring out what it's going to cost. And then I can give you a real proposal for how much time and how much money that's going to cost. It's very hard to do that before you know what the task is going to be.
Yeah.
You know, so, and a lot of our clients have been open to that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we say, this is not a huge commitment. Let's write a agreement to do this first 3 month exercise. We'll create a vision. We'll put together some renderings. We'll have some floor plans. We'll get some preliminary budget pricing. You'll be able to use this for your fundraising, which is usually like their first phase.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we'll jump on board and do the actual design.
Right. So you're actually kind of chunking down the full architectural service into like a feasibility study or even pre-design work or some kind of...
Like calling it a vision design because I think that's really what it is. We kind of try to work with them on figuring out what it is that they really need and what we can do with their existing building or their new building in order to achieve that. You know, when it's clients that don't want to do that and kind of want a full on proposal, I think then you kind of do what typically architects do, which is to try to define the scope of work and the budget and the schedule and make it clear that anything beyond that is going to be additional services, which will be figured out in some way. And that's also okay if we do a proposal and it turns out that it is, you know, they want to do something much bigger and more interesting than, or much smaller, then, you know, we can renegotiate or negotiate that change later on.
And it's quite interesting. You've done a lot of work with kind of religious institutions or with synagogues. Now, these types of projects can be very challenging if you're working with kind of multi-headed clients. I.e. there's a kind of, like, there isn't always a singular person who's at the helm, or there's a committee that needs to be consulted. Sometimes the committee is, you know, part of the community. Therefore, they are not full-time, you know, they've got other jobs and other lives that they're leading. It just adds to a level of complexity and management, which requires a lot of interpersonal skill and coordination. How have you... have you experienced those kinds of challenges? And if you have, how have you sort of learned to navigate or deal with them?
I think there are different kinds of institutions and different management styles. So we, for example, the 14th Street Y that I initially mentioned had a very strong executive director, and it was very clear that, you know, if he was sold on the proposal, that was a go-ahead. And there was a board and there were committees, but it was really kind of him making the major decisions and the assistant director kind of managing how that happens. And that was a very easy process,
right,
in that sense.
It's been much more centralized. On
the synagogues, there are also different types of institutions. So we did a synagogue renovation out in Skokie, which is a suburb of Chicago, where there was a small volunteer committee with a very strong chair. Mm-hmm. And so the process was quite simple. And, you know, when they were convinced, it was a go-ahead. And yes, we had to present to various other groups and members and the rabbi, but it was clear, it was fairly clear how decisions were being made, and pretty fast.
Yeah.
Other synagogues have a much more complicated organizational structure, and it definitely can become very challenging. It can also become challenging because if it's a larger committee and there are different voices on the committee, and some people can be, you know, more confrontational versus other people who are kind of more collaborative. And so you're trying to manage that, the committee itself, their kind of inner workings, mm-hmm. and also the messaging that comes from that committee towards the larger community. And I think one thing that I have learned from that experience is that, first of all, you have to add to your schedule and budget and proposal lots of hours for various meetings. You know, weekly committee meetings can become pretty onerous.
Yeah.
And often they have to be in the evening because people have jobs. So you're meeting from like 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. every week or every other week, which is, you know, a big commitment and mm-hmm. not very convenient for family life. But the other thing is that it's really important to take a leadership position as the architect, to kind of speak clearly from the point of an expert, that sometimes the kind of group dynamic of a committee can derail the sense of the direction of the project. And while we're on the one hand kind of giving a service to our clients, we're also hired because of our expertise and experience and judgment. And
right.
we need to kind of hold that balance of, you know, being responsive to people's concerns and people's anxiety and people's wishes, but also, you know, sometimes you just have to say, listen, we've done this many times and we know this is a stressful process, and we know right now it feels like nothing is going right, but we have a great team, we have great consultants, we have a good contractor, we're all working to make this a successful project, and you have to trust that us, that we're going to deliver what we're, you know, what we've promised. And, mm-hmm. You know, I think that's sometimes hard to do. And sometimes you have to do that to more than just one group. You can't just speak to the committee, but you have to speak to the entire community on, you know, like a informational Zoom meeting, or to the rabbis and cantors. But I think communication and, you know, a sense of confidence that you can give. And confidence doesn't mean that we're always right. I think that's another piece of it. You know, I have learned that it's equally important to sometimes say, you know, I'm sorry, we made a mistake. You know, we missed this. Mm-hmm. I wish we didn't. This is going to cost some money to fix it. But it's part of the normal process of renovating an old building. Mm-hmm. And often once you say, you know, you're sorry and you made a mistake, there's not that, they can't continue harassing you, right? Yeah. You've already apologized. And let's move on. We're a team and let's figure out how to fix this.
Well, and like you say, you can also, you know, prepare a client to be like, you know what, there's going to be stuff that we're going to miss. Yep. We're going to have a contingency in place for this. You know,
absolutely.
We're working with a building where we can't foresee all of the expectations. I mean, this is really interesting what you're saying, actually, that, you know, the architect as or in a leadership position in the kind of the whole process, right? Because you're leading the client, you're leading other consultants, you're bringing together the team in many cases. And being at the helm, being the leader is actually very difficult, because there's a lot of, you know, what comes with being the leader is, number one, being accountable and being responsible. And number two is like actually having the, you know, you've got to have conversations, let's say, which inherently have some kind of collision involved in them, or not saying that they're adversarial or necessarily confrontational, but you know, they're not always lovey-dovey agreeable conversations. Like you have to stand for the vision of the project and for what the client is saying. The vision, sometimes the client gets in the way of their own vision, and also you've got to, you know, have difficult conversations with your own team members sometimes. How have you kind of expanded your leadership? What sorts of challenges did you say used to have when you first started the business compared to the kind of, how have your challenges evolved or matured to what you deal with now?
I think the main thing you learn out of after working for 10 or 15 or 20 years, or hopefully continuing longer, is a certain maturity of life. I think I think of it a little bit when I look at my daughters. I have two teenage daughters. One is just finished high school. She's 18. Another one's 16. And every experience that they have, or not every, but many of their experiences, it's the first time this happened, right? It's the first time that someone has been mean in a particular way, or it's the first time they're, you know, dating someone, or it's the first time they've gone on an airplane alone. And those are, you know, exciting experiences, but also very overwhelming. And you really don't exactly know how they're, you haven't had the experience to know that it's all going to work out and it's going to be fine. And, you know, these friends are fighting and it's all going to be, either you'll continue being their friend and that's great, or you won't be their friend and that's also fine, right? You know, that some people are not worth it. So I think one of the things you learn from working is just that, you know, for the most part, it's going to be okay. You have that kind of wisdom. And I think it's one of those things that you learn as you kind of get more experience, is the difference between just people who are smart and creative. I think we were very, very enamored by that. These like brilliant people who are either really intelligent or super creative. And then there's another kind of talent that's a little bit different, which is this like wisdom, this kind of knowing how to take those exciting, intelligent, creative, groundbreaking, or not even groundbreaking, or just, you know, very good designs, and shepherding them through the process and getting them actually built, and getting them built with your clients being happy at the end, and getting them built with your contractors feeling like they are also proud and part of the project, and they're not everyone suing everyone. And whether that's like emotional intelligence or just kind of a certain maturity, I don't know exactly what's the right term, but I feel like that's something that our culture sometimes forgets to appreciate.
Yes.
And is part of not just doing good work, but doing good at work and having a good life. You know, like, it doesn't all have to be high drama.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this is an interesting point to talk a little bit about. I know you've, a little while ago, you started working with a management coach, a mutual friend of ours, the fabulous Douglas Teager, who, you know, I've got, you know, love dearly and got a lot of time for. What was it that had you reach out and start working with someone like Doug? What were sorts of things in the business that you felt that it was important to have that kind of outside consultant, kind of look inside of the business and give guidance?
So we talked about leaving big firms and taking some of that knowledge. And I think some of the knowledge that I took and many people take from the firms they worked at has to do with how to do the architectural part. Mm-hmm. I think very few, unless you're kind of pretty high up as a partner at a firm, I didn't have a lot of insight into how the Pei firm was working financially and contractually and how they were tracking things, and which they may or may not have been doing. I really, it was kind of a side of the business that we were not privy to.
Yeah.
So when I kind of started my firm, I figured out my own processes, and I think they were very good and sufficient as long as we were fairly small. So when we had, two or three people, I felt like I had good control of our projects. But over the last few years, we have grown to kind of 7 or 8 people and, maybe between 10 and 14 projects at a time. And suddenly just kind of looking into our checking account and seeing how much cash was in there was not really the right way to kind of assess the profitability and the efficiency of our office. And so I felt like there were different things that I was lacking. One of them was kind of a sense of, where we are financially, both as a firm and also in relation to each specific projects, like which of our projects we were making money on, which we weren't. And I wasn't coming it from the sense that every project has to be hugely profitable. Mm-hmm. I'm very comfortable with some projects being, more of our money-making projects and other ones being something that we do partly because we love doing it and have a much smaller profit margin on those. But I didn't have that information. I didn't feel like I actually knew what was going on a project basis. And then, also being able to plan a little bit more, like, can I hire another person? I feel like we have a lot of work, but, can I afford to hire one person or two people? Can I afford to pay for someone who would be doing more marketing and business development? So those were the kind of measures that I felt like I did not have control over. And I kind of spent quite some time just looking online, trying to figure out if there's information out there that I could just, pay for and get mm-hmm. from someone, or if there were companies that would give that kind of consulting, and somehow happened upon Douglas Teeger, and we met on Zoom, and I really enjoyed our first meeting and ever since. So I've learned so much from mm-hmm. him. There are parts of his type of, I think he has also different areas in which he can consult. So
yeah.
The parts that I have used the most had to do with the financial side of the office. Those have been the ones that have been the most beneficial for me. The other parts are just the ability to talk to someone with a lot of experience and run things by them, like, hey, this thing happened, my client is saying this, or they don't want to pay this bill, or how would I manage that, or how would you think about it? So we've talked about those kind of situations, a little bit about managing staff, mm-hmm. Learning a little bit better what that means to be a boss of a bigger firm, learning to let go a little bit, let people have more leadership, more ownership of their own projects, freeing up more time for me to not only, do the work, but also think about the direction we want the firm to take, and the intellectual project that is part of the architectural project we're doing. So it's been a real delight for me. It's been a piece that I didn't know I was missing, and I didn't know that I could get. And I'm very grateful that I found him, and I'm very grateful of the work we've been able to do together.
Amazing, amazing. We kind of touched upon a little bit earlier about your understanding of psychoanalysis. And this is something that you've lectured on in conjunction with kind of design. And we were talking about it earlier in terms of like kind of mapping out a family tree of architecture. And obviously the work that you do with Doug, I know that they, you know, he has his own wisdom for sure. And in kind of interpersonal communication and dealing with people and the psychology. And you were just mentioning there, you know, kind of dealing with these, with some of these difficult conversations with clients and, you know, just, you know, kind of having yourself let go so that team members can step into their own leadership. What role does your understanding of psychoanalysis come into your own leadership?
So I think there are two pieces that I'm interested in terms of the kind of use of psychoanalysis. I think the first part of it is really very personal, and it's about being able to better understand yourself and better mm-hmm. understand your reactions to others around you and the ways that you become yourself in relation to others. So the type of person I am as a child to my parents is different than the type of person I am as a parent to my children, yes. hopefully. And that awareness, I think, is something that has helped me be a more attuned person in general. And I think brings a lot to the way I try to relate to both everyone around me. And mm-hmm. architecture is a very social project, right? We're not artists in our own studio kind of creating a piece and then putting it out there for someone to buy or curate. We're always from the start working with our own teams in our office, our clients and their own, you know, desires and anxieties and baggage. And then all the rest of the team, the consultants, the finance people, the owner's reps, the clients, the contractors. So being able to have a kind of deeper awareness of how I react, you know, when I become defensive, when I become insecure, and how that makes me respond in a way that might not be productive. I think that comes into the what we touched about in terms of leadership, mm-hmm. having a certain, you know, sense of integrity and confidence, and also the ability to kind of pivot when needed, or even, you know, even meet a client and realize that this is not going to be a successful project, even though maybe there's a good budget, and just say kind of, you know, sorry, we're too busy and we can't take on this project. So I think that self-awareness is something that guides me very much in the kind of work I do. I think the other side of it that we don't talk so much about is just the both social and emotional aspects of buildings, right? So we're not creating neutral spaces. We're creating spaces that people live in or interact in, mm-hmm. whether they're personal spaces or social spaces. And those experiences have kind of very deep emotional foundations, and trying to think about those in a way, I think some of the psychoanalytic research helped me think about that in kind of more clear terms. So one of the things I've been thinking about in terms of designing synagogues has to do with that balance of what it means to be what it means to have a spiritual moment or a mm-hmm. reflective moment that is both intimate. So people want to have some kind of connection to something divine, maybe, when mm-hmm. they come to pray. But they do this in a communal space. They come to a church or a synagogue or a mosque to do that. They're not doing this on a mountain by themselves. So what is it that we're looking for when we try to have a contemplative, religious, spiritual experience within a community? And how do we try to hold those two experiences, that sense that the community is giving us maybe a security net to have a kind of this experience, or that it enhances this experience? And I think so in psychoanalysis, there's a sense that there's this interpersonal experience where, you know, I can be more vulnerable because someone else is giving me the kind of confidence that they'll save me from falling apart, whether it's the therapist or my partner or a friend, right? So I feel like in some of these communal spaces, we are able to experience more of our emotional life because we are within a community. And maybe it's also the reason people go to a rock concert, right? Like you can feel the pain of a breakup or the joys of love or being aware of mortality, these really profound experiences that we choose to do with others. And how can architecture or these spaces that we create allow this to happen in the most profound and meaningful way? And mm-hmm. so I don't know if that was going off too far for you.
No,
I
mean,
I feel like this is something that, has opened to me kind of another way of thinking about the architectural process.
I love this. I think it's so fascinating just to, consider the kind of human need to be part of a community and a group. And that doing these things, even something like prayer, which is so intimate and personal and kind of in solitude, but yet we choose to do it in a group in order to effectively, magnify the experience that we might individually be having. Same thing going to a sports game or to, the reason why you go to a football game, even if you don't like football, or soccer or American football, whatever, like that, it's hard not to get moved by the rapture of the audience. When a goal goes in and the whole audience is just screaming, it's like, wow, that's quite incredible. And having these kind of profound moments in solitude or communion with divinity, or exploring that, imagine that, doing that with a group, that's incredibly empowering and creates more in like the experience to endure. And deepens it, and I think it's very interesting. Just kind of in modern leadership, we are talking so much more nowadays about self-reflection and self-awareness and the ability to kind of you having a series of tools to be able to analyze your own subjective experience of the world, and being able to do that and kind of have an audit of it, then opens up a much more powerful way of communicating with another person, as opposed to just communicating with your own thinking about the other person. Now you can actually communicate with them as they are. And in running a business, this becomes enormously important when we're dealing with human beings all the time. And we often step over our own, subjectivity around something, which then, this has very real impacts. It leads to arguments, it leads to conflict, it leads to things not working well, it leads to complaints brewing in an office that go unheard or unsaid, and then people leave and then their careers go in different directions. So I think it's really, really, it's very important kind of body of knowledge to be bringing into both the design of buildings and the design of our businesses.
Yeah. And I think that's another interesting piece, your that last sentence, the design of our businesses, because I think, and that goes back maybe a little bit to what we talked about about Doug Teeger, but as architects, we are good at designing things. And then you have to step back and think, how do I want to craft this thing, which is my business, which is not just a kind of professional financial entity. It's also a way of life, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, I started my business before I had kids, but pretty early on, I realized that the kind of work-life balance that I'm looking for has to do with being able to go home in a reasonable hour and give my kids dinner and read them a story before bedtime. And so there were types of projects which I just was happy to kind of give up because I didn't think that they would foster that type of professional practice. So, you know, if you're working for a big developer and they're paying interest on their loan, and so you have to do it as quickly as possible, those can be great projects, but I kind of decided those were not the type of projects I wanted to do or the type of practice I wanted to have.
Yeah.
And in a similar way, I was kind of happy to create a practice in which everyone in the office has a kind of similar response or sensibility. You know, we work at reasonable hours, we work well, we're very collaborative, we help each other. Everyone has really good relationships with the clients, and people have stayed for many years. And, you know, there are other ways to craft your own practice. So you could have lots of very inexpensive interns. You can have a lot of junior people who are like great at some things, but, you know, very young in other things.
Yeah.
In the ways they maybe communicate with people or in the types of experiences they've had.
Sure.
So my office tends to be, well, we're actually like almost all women. I don't know if that's just a fluke, but but we also tend to be, you know, a little bit older, and everyone has, I would say, at least 10 years of experience, if not 30.
Wow.
And so it leads to a certain kind of work environment, and which, you know, I'm glad I was able to kind of be aware of what it was I was looking for and, you know, be able to craft it to achieve that.
Amazing. Brilliant. Well, I think that's the perfect place to conclude the conversation. We're just coming up to our time here. Esther, thank you so much for that really rich and enlightening conversation and just giving us a glimpse into Studio ST. So I really enjoyed speaking with you.
Thank you so much. It's one of those things, I think it's going back to kind of what I said about psychoanalysis, is when you talk to other people, you kind of figure out more something new about yourself. And so it was a pleasure for me too. Really wonderful.
Awesome. And that's a wrap. And don't forget, if you want to access your free training to learn how to structure your firm or practice for freedom, fulfillment, and profit, please visit smartpracticemethod.com. Or if you'd like to speak to one of our advisors directly, follow the link in the information. The views expressed on this show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment, except to help you be unstoppable.